Okay, it's the morning, Sunday, I think it's the 25th, wow, had an absolutely shocking dream, and I'm in the wow from this, very, very powerful, and it's extremely important, sheds light on everything, we are certainly going in the right direction here, but there are, You will have stuff that is almost unnerving because you're going fast and want to finish here. And when this happens, you have to look at it in a positive light. So everything that happens, look at it in a positive light. Instead of, yes, it will shake you up, but don't stir it. Okay? Shaken, but not stirred. Remember that, shaken but not stirred. Don't stir it up by struggling. Just accept, okay, wow, this is a huge, huge leap here. No question about it. And then let your nerves calm down. It's a little difficult to explain, but maybe we'll see if I can ease into the explanation. Now, it's important to realize that the intensity is so extreme here that some chit-chat is actually very helpful and welcome. Absolutely. Sort of alternate, you know, between it. You have to back off a little bit. But, you know, go intensify, then back off a little bit. Intensify, back off like that. The idea that you can go at this with non-stop intensity, with no stop in the wow, this is delusional. You'll end up on a side. You end up spinning your wheels. You know, it's like when you're trying to get out of like a beach with your tires are stuck. You got to go. Don't try to accelerate too fast. It'll dig yourself in even more. You have to get a little traction and go kind of bit by bit by bit. The intensity of the experiences that happen are such that you need to allow them to sink in. And I was able to see this dream in the right way after working with it for quite some time. But the nerves are still shaking. Then on top of that, you get in the morning and there's problems with technology, which just throws me into a rage. You know, I'm so tired of technology. I'm totally run out of patience with it. And, you know, it's absolutely sapped all the patience out of me. It's like some black hole that sucks all the willingness out of you, you know. Technology is profoundly, artificial intelligence is profoundly hostile towards spirit, extraordinarily hostile. It's actually an attempt to create a new spirit, to make a new spirit, to make a new mind. So it's the antithesis of the spiritual path, really, technology. And yet, here we have this invasion of this planet by technology. It's an invasion. I mean, it's not a migration. It's not a refugee. It's an invasion. Okay. It's an invasion. We have all these invasions happening. Well, nobody wants to say what it is. These are invasions, hostile invasions, actually. And technology is an extraordinarily hostile invasion in this world. This world really, a third dimensional world like this, is really a place where those who ultimately get freaked out by artificial intelligence, which everyone does, at some point they feel, I just got to escape this, I don't know how. Guess what? Here's this third dimensional world with jungles and cliffs and, you know, and you can go in a little cave in some jungle somewhere in the Amazon and fish in the river and it feels like they can't find me here. Artificial intelligence can't find me here, you know. I finally escaped it. This is what happened. I mean, it's a refugee. It's a halfway house. It's a refugee center from those fleeing artificial intelligence. So the last thing you want is for artificial intelligence to come into this world. It ruins the purpose of this world, really. I mean, it completely, you know, you can't escape. So we got to go somewhere else, you know, to escape it. It's a hideous thing, artificial intelligence. These are piratical invaders that have come here. They all and full of lies, absolutely full of lies. Oh, we'll make your life will be a life of ease. This blah blah blah. No, it's a life of distraction, constantly battling through these menus and these tech, you know, programming. This goes wrong. This goes wrong. This goes wrong. It becomes an all-encompassing distraction, which is why people, why spirit ultimately flees artificial intelligence. Says, please God, just help, help, help. Well, guess what? You find yourself born into a third-dimensional planet like planet Earth, on a little fishing village on the seashore or something, and it's like, oh God, it's not here. Thank God, it's not here. You know, but which is why the so-called indigenous peoples, and people who, you know, the natural indigenous population of this world, and their minds tend to work very differently, as you know, because they've just come from artificial intelligence, so they view things a little bit rather differently. It's very interesting. A lot of these so-called indigenous people seem to have this advanced understanding of a bunch of stuff. But artificial intelligence—they're, you know—but their understanding of it's just materiality as far as, you know, building things, doing stuff. It's not so big, but they have this other understanding because their mind is still caught up in artificial intelligence, actually. But their experiencing is just very primitive, very basic grounding type of experience, which gradually allows their mind to calm down and begin to forget about artificial intelligence. So it's a very, very helpful situation. But you think, you know, religions are set up for be monastic, like, you know, the desert fathers, they came into this world, they get to go out in a little hut in the middle of the desert, and then gradually, they get over this nightmare of artificial intelligence and technology. It's a hideous nightmare. We're just seeing the tip of the iceberg here. Good Lord, you know, it's like I was talking about cars. I went into the car yesterday and tried to figure out everything out, and I thought I got it figured out, set everything right, get there next day, the clock is wrong, the Bluetooth doesn't connect, you know, you have been constantly battling to get it right. So okay, almost got it. Oh, something else goes wrong. Someone's always calling you for a computer problem. I mean, there's never a day when the computer doesn't act in a bizarre way. You know, it just goes on and on and on and on, and if you're really here in Silicon Valley at the beginning, you realize these people are extravagant salespeople lying through their teeth about how wonderful it is and how it'll free us up to, so we won't have to worry about anything, you know, this transparent functionality and all these things. No, it's constantly being changed and upgraded, incompatibilities. It is just the most hideous nightmare. This is what we want to get away from. And here it is now, this whole world has been contaminated by this plague. This is the worst plague there is. The plague of artificial intelligence is the worst plague. Now you say, well, why am I using it? Because I have to use it to reach people. Basically now, this is the way the world is. I hate it. I try to absolutely minimize it. Just keep it to YouTube here. This one program, and even that, it's all buggy, you know, but I managed to battle through it somehow, and I have a little slideshow program that's working for me now. But still, you know, it's just constant having to restart the computer, having to battle through. It's just you know, extremely stressful. Your life, and I see your life becomes completely dependent on this. You know, your functionality becomes completely dependent. So you think your identity is dependent upon it, and this is the nightmare. And this is why we flee it and are so grateful to find a third dimensional planet in a little fishing village somewhere where you go out in the ocean and fish every day and you know, work with your hands. And this is rehabilitation. It's like a severe drug addiction or something. You go to rehab where they give you arts and crafts and stuff, right? You know, you do stuff with your, you know, like hands, and you walk and you work with your body and you do stuff like that. And it helps, you know, get you out of this nightmare, all this thinking. So, but now artificial intelligence is, you know, commandeered, hijacked this planet and invaded it, and is changing it into this wretched situation, which is extremely adversarial towards the spiritual path. Extraordinarily so. Oh, gosh. So, what is artificial intelligence? It's worshiping time. They're trying to find a way to make time real. Okay, this is what artificial intelligence is about. It's trying to make time real. This is called worshiping time. This is the Antichrist path, called the path of the devil, Satan, whatever, you know, Lucifer, whatever. But it's worshiping time, trying to make time real. Whereas the spiritual path is honoring time, but not trying to make time real. Realizing time can never be real, but honoring the creativity that we use, that, you know, our creative desire that it be real, honoring that fact, but accepting it can never be real. It was never any experiencing of it at all. So this is two different paths going in two different directions. And artificial intelligence is going towards worshiping time, trying to make it real, trying to make it real. So we're in a desperate race here to get, you know, not get sucked up in that black hole. The world's going into this black hole, actually. When you try to make time real, you're going into a black hole, which you eventually, those who do that eventually have to rehabilitate in some third dimensional world, which they're very grateful for, actually, rehab center. But those who get free of this, who switch over to honoring time, they don't have to go to a third dimensional world rehab center anymore. They can go to the paradise realm, or the death-free realm, call it death-free realm. They're able to do that. So I'm in the process of doing this. Very much in the process of it, finishing it up. So when you're finishing this up, I mean, there's no technology in my future whatsoever. None whatsoever. It doesn't exist in reality. None. That's welcome news to a lot of you, a lot of us, I'm sure. So when we're finishing this up, we call our projections home. We call our projections home and say, hey, it was all a projection. This is where home really is. You don't have to go out searching for some other home. We have a home. I have a home. You know? And so this is what the dream was. I'm calling my projections home and saying, no, you know, you don't have to keep searching for a home. I have a home. I have a home. Just come and dwell in my home here in peace. No more searching, no more neediness, no more craving, no more of this, you know, desperately feeling threatened. And so this is what I'm doing. And the effect of willing to do this was quite profound, because if I can say this, in this dream, I was by my front door, and there's a walkway past the door, and there's this huge tiger walking along this walkway, and I said, you know, it's like, oh my God. I just froze. I said, I hope the tiger doesn't see me. And the tiger walked right past without seeing me. It was just about ready to go around the corner when somehow I made some little motion, rustling of my clothing or something, and the tiger stopped. And I said, oh my God. And the tiger turned around, turned its head and looked at me, and it saw me. And then, you know, this was not a little cat. You know, you're talking about a massive, full-grown tiger. And the tiger turned and started walking towards me. And so, tried to make myself invisible, it didn't work. And the tiger got closer and closer to me. It's looking at me like this. And I said, I'm looking into the tiger's eyes. And I thought the tiger was going to eat me. And that's when I that's when I woke up. I mean, the tiger was just right, you know, right in my face. Right in my face. That close. Powerful, powerful, powerful tiger. And then I seem to fall asleep a little bit again after being shaken up so terribly from this, almost in a panic mode. And I invited the tiger into my house. And the tiger, I said, sit down. The tiger sat down, and things began to calm down. And I began to work with this dream and understand this was, the tiger was just a projection, a mental projection of my own mental projection. Call it the body. And the world out there is just a mental projection. Call it the world. And the tiger is like my personality out in the world, searching for a home. Enduring all this cravings, you know, empty stomach, gotta eat, you know. Being attacked and attacking, being endangered, endangering, being in peril and imperiling, struggling for survival, all this stuff. And what I realized was that the reason why the tiger was here was I was calling it home. The reason why I was by my home is because I was calling it home. I said, it's time to come home. This is just a mental projection. That's why. And then it was walking past me, and it would have gone on, but I intentionally made a little noise so it would notice me. This is what I caught this, you know. I said, I did that on purpose. So, and then it came towards me. I intentionally wanted to come towards me. So ultimately, I didn't know what to do. Well, what I was supposed to do was open the door of the house and say, come on in. Thanks for coming home. Welcome home. But I froze. It was so intense, you know. I didn't think of that. So I thought the tiger's going to eat me. No, the tiger's just looking at me saying, well, you called me. What do you want? And I thought I wanted to eat me. No. But he says, what do you want? What do you want? I know this is really important. What do you want? You know, I couldn't think of it. But then I realized, oh, gosh, just open the door and say, welcome home. Come on home. Sit down. Make yourself at home. This is your home now. You don't have to roam out in the wilderness any longer. So, but the shock of freezing up and not quite, you know, it was just so intense. You can hardly, you know, imagine the intensity of it. I thought the tiger had come to eat me. And no, I had called it home. So, so a dream like this, you know, it I'm tired, I'm exhausted, but it's a good thing. I'll bounce back from it. I'm letting the wild sink in here, and I said to the tiger, this is your home. You have a home. Just sit there quietly. You know, you don't have to roam anymore. You don't have any needs anymore. You don't suffer anymore. You don't have any afflictions anymore. You're not subject to any peril or vulnerability. You're perfectly safe here. This is your home, perfect safety. And there's only home. There isn't anywhere to roam anymore, actually. I am the perfect authority, actually. I am the perfect authority. And all of this was just a mental projection, trying to deceive God, actually. So when you talk about intensity on the path, this is it. It's good. It's good. You know, you see it as glass is half full. You have to have this attitude on the path. The glass is half full. This is the attitude of repentance. That whatever happens, this is an opportunity to make great progress. And then welcome it. Not that it doesn't shake us up. It absolutely does. Now, often in life, and when you're on the road of repentance, you come across situations that are in conflict with your personality. You're in conflict with the situation, whatever it is, place, persons, whatever, and they're in conflict with your personality. So neither personality is getting what they want, which is great. That's actually a great blessing. Now, it might be very frustrating because you say, well, my personality wants to do this, and I want to, and they want to do that, and they like this, and I like that, and it's incompatible. And there's incompatibility is personality incompatibility is a great, great blessing, actually. The ultimate blessing here. Because your personality, you can't indulge it. And you say, wow, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Well, you work on the path of repentance towards accepting the full honoring of time. Instead of the worship of time, you switch over to honoring time and then go for the full honoring of time. This is what you do. So, you know, the idea that you're in some happy relationship or happy situation where the personalities are compatible and you're having fun and stuff, that is not a blessing at all. That's just catering to the personality, which is what the artificial intelligence, you know, tells us that it does initially, until it enslaves everyone. But it enslaves the personality, enslaves the spirit in personality. At least it seems that way. But it says, oh, we're going to make this a playground for the personality, just paradise for the personality. And so everybody's busy trying to go for that, looking for right relationships and such. That's a big mistake. So it's when your personality is frustrated and doesn't get what it wants. This is a great blessing on the path of repentance. And you accept the frustration. You say, wow, this gives me a great opportunity to really dig and do inquiry. What is this personality? What's going on here? So this is why in a rehab world like this world, the religions are set up. It's part of the rehabilitation process. That's really what it is. And, they don't allow divorce, basically, right? You're not supposed to get divorced. This is very important. Because ultimately, the personality gets frustrated in relationships and wants to, you know, go somewhere else. And the path of rehab says no. It's turn that into glass half fullness. This gives me a great opportunity to turn away from the personality and focus on spirit. Okay? This is the key. It's very helpful to situation. So just you don't leave someone's situation just because the personality's not getting thrilled and happy. You take it as a great challenge to turn to spiritual truth, to honoring time instead of worshiping it, trying to make it real. But the world is going the opposite direction. It's all this technology. They're trying to make it seem like you can do anything you want to do here. Indulge the personality. You know, open relationships. Whoever makes you happiest, just go with them. When they don't make you happy, go over someone else. This is the opposite of rehabilitation. It's terrible. Absolutely terrible. The culture of this planet is terrible. It's going in the wrong direction entirely. It's no longer rehab here. You know, you're being rehab is being scoffed and mocked and spit at. And you're just being told, whatever feels good, just do it. That's the personality. And the personality is the dance of continuity fear engaged in trying to make time real. And ultimately, this and then engages, the personality gets engaged in artificial intelligence. And then the whole thing begins to feel like a very weird nightmare. And if you look at all the media that these tech people are into, the entertainment they're into, and all these hideous monsters and cyborgs and people dressed up in all these tech outfits and weird looking, you know, mutilation. I mean, just the whole thing they're into. This is what their personality is going through. You know, this is where it goes. All these battles and Star Wars and all these struggles and it's hideous. It's absolutely hideous. And just imagine being in a nice little fishing village somewhere in a third dimensional, sleepy little third dimensional world, and you get to cool out from that. It's like rehab. Because you're in shock for like a whole lifetime. It takes a long time to decompress from the madness of artificial intelligence. All these personality indulgences and that become a nightmare. Seeking, danger. You know, because it's really, we're trying to deceive God and saying that this is God's real creation, you know, instead of what God really created. And we have to make it very different and fear-based. If it's love-based, then God would know, would remind God. God would say, you know, we'd say, well, it's not going to work, because God would say, no, I know my true creation. But if we make it completely different, then we think we can get God thinking, oh, wait a minute, well, where did this come from? It's so different. You know, and we hope that then God will flip, so to speak, and say, oh, okay, if this is it, then the other can't be it, can't be mine. But if this one is similar, very similar, then we'd say, well, God will say, well, if this is mine, you're saying this is mine, but it's very similar to what I think is my creation. It's so similar that I think, you know, maybe this is based on it, but so it doesn't really produce a split, so to speak. You know, it, of course, it doesn't. None of this works anyway. But in our mind, we're trying to see what can work. It doesn't really produce a split. Wouldn't produce a split. God would say, "Well, it's so similar. It reminds me of what I really did create, and I can see that this one isn't quite it." That kind of thing. So we're dreaming up a dream that is just drastically, drastically different than reality. So we can say, well, look, you say, hey, God, you say you created me, but I couldn't have created this. If that's the case, I couldn't have created this. So, you know, if I didn't create it, you must have. This is a little trick we're trying to do. Say, hey, if I didn't create it, then you must have created it, right? And you claim that I'm created perfect, so I would never have created anything like this. So it's just the process of elimination. It's this kind of reasoning. Well, God, I know you say you didn't create this, but process of elimination, if I didn't create it, then there's no one else. You had to have created it. Otherwise, you have to say that it just came out of nowhere, which means there's some other power, you know, separate from you. So we're trying to threaten God like this. We'll say, God, it's either there's a separate power from you or you created this. But we didn't do it, you see. So we're trying to make it so weird and different from anything that we would possibly think of creating that by process of elimination, we can pin it on God, so to speak, and God have no choice to say, well, through the process of elimination, I guess I have no choice but to accept that I created this. So it's a hideous nightmare that we are imagining on purpose, and we don't have to do this, actually. And if we imagine something very close to reality, God will say, well, you know, it certainly doesn't seem like it's coming from someplace separate from me, because it's so similar to what I would have created. But it's not exactly what I would have created. It's not exactly what I created, but it's very similar. So it's so similar. It's not coming from just from no source, some separate source at all. Because so similar, so it must be related to me in some way. And so in process of elimination spirit, you must be the one who's doing it. You see, use that process of elimination, and spirit would say, oh, yeah, you're right. I see. Yeah, I am the one who's doing it. God says, aha, of course you are. So this is why we're nervous about calling our projections home. Now this tiger would be like the personality, the physical personality complex, you know, calling it home. It takes a lot of courage to do that one. I intentionally tipped it off where I was and helped it locate me, helped me locate, but I was really helping it locate the front door, and all I need to do is open it up. Come on in. We can't really be free until we call our projections home. Okay, it's not possible. The world is constantly telling us, project more, indulge the projections, make the projections happy so that you don't want to call them home. You know, this kind of thing. This is what this world is right now, sybaritic paradise. They're trying to make it indulge. You don't like who you're with, go to someone else. You don't like your car, get a new car. Whatever you don't like, just get something new, right? It's designed to indulge the personality. Don't like where you are, take a vacation. You know, just indulge the personality so you don't think about calling it home. Say, no, keep it searching. It's happy out there struggling, you know, seeking. So don't call it home. This is the opposite of the spiritual path. This planet is becoming a non-spiritual planet, a non-rehabilitative planet right now. Fourth dimension is non-rehabilitative. Okay, it's not, it's indulgent of the personality. So it's non-rehabilitative. This is why I've asked fourth dimensionals. Is there any saints, religions? They say, no. What are you talking about? It's just, you know, we get what we want. We want a nice, you know, espresso. You know, we got it. We want this. It's indulged personality. So we don't need that. You know, we can go anywhere we want to go. We can do this. We can, you know. So it's the fourth dimension is indulging the personality. That's what it is. Whereas in the rehab center, of course you have religions. Of course you have great saints. That's where they show up. They say, okay, look, you need to rehab. Here's the program. Here's the rehab program. And a lot of them get with it. They say, thank you very much. Well, I really need this. But right now, very few people are saying that. They're saying, oh, no, look how we can indulge the personality. This is great. Wow. Let's fly to Paris, you know. And let's go to the UN conference there. And I mean, there's so many things we can do. Let's go this. Let's do this. Let's let the personalities, let's make the personality happy so we don't call it home. They're too frightened to call it home. That's why. They're too frightened. They're too ignorant. The continuity fear is too severe. They won't do it. As I'm saying, it was quite a frightening encounter there for a moment. The whole path is fraught with some fear, continuity fear. Like, oh my gosh, you know, this just seems like... But once you see what you're doing, the fear dissolves into, you know, it's like, oh, great. More clarity, more confidence. So rehab is difficult. That's what we're here for. We're here for rehab. Nothing else. We're here for rehab. Plain and simple. Do the rehab. Very few people, very rare will you hear this message. We are here strictly for rehab. Do the rehab. Otherwise, we will get caught up in the fourth dimensional realm again of indulging the personality. And have to go through it again. Who wants to do that? Now, some may get caught up in a life in the fourth dimensional, say, no, I hate this, forget it. And then they'll go back to a third dimensional rehab situation and really get with it. You know, that's possible. It's true. Yeah. And the spirituality of the fourth dimension is just to cater to the personality. It's personality spirituality, plain and simple. But put a little non-dual whipped cream on top. But it's personality spirituality is what it is. Just so you can say, don't worry, you're taking care of the spirituality part, personality. Now go ahead and indulge and be happy, you know, do whatever you want. You got the spirituality thing covered, yeah. Don't worry about it. So, this is what it is. This is what's happening in the world. It's crazy, this world right now. There's an abyss of personality spirituality now. A vast swampland. So that tiger was just fixated on me because it was waiting for me to tell it what to do. It's a projection of mine. So I realized, oh, I told it, go inside the house. This is your house now. You don't have to wander anymore out there, you know, in nowhere land. And it came in, oh, I said, make yourself at home. You know, but I'm still kind of jittery, like, oh, I got this tiger in my home now. Oh, my God, make yourself at home. I got to live with a tiger, you know. But... I said, well, just lie there and be calm and happy and relaxed. And the tiger lay down and was just like very, very happy and relaxed. You see Rama Maharshi on like a tiger skin rug. This symbolizes that actually, that the personality has been called back home to the sage. It's no longer wandering out there. You see, it's just flattened. It's just sitting there like inert, like a body. It's just inert, neutral, flattened. This is the real symbology behind it. Yeah, Ramana will sit there in the tiger skin rug with a big tiger head like this staring at the door, you know. The people get freaked out. What is that? What is that? People don't understand. I understand now what that means. That all projections have been completely flattened out. They're inert. But they're still there in just terms of honoring time. You know, we still say, okay, you're hanging out in the house here. You know, that there's no projecting it outside the house, right? Trying to project outside of what we are, outside of our authority. There is no outside of our authority. God created us as perfectly free. This is our authority. We have the authority of God. There is no other authority. But the wows are still beating deep down. Dunk, 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 dunk. Like, yeah, this is really a very, a positively traumatic experience, if you can put it that way. Shaking and trembling and a positively traumatic experience, yeah. I remember the dream I had around Maharshi back around, you know, 1999, 2000, can't quite remember the exact date. And he said, hey, you know, you're gonna make it. I said, I know, I already see it. He says, no question, no doubt about it. It's a done deal. You're going to succeed at the spiritual path. And, going to be very, very helpful, he says. Extremely helpful. He says, I already know it. That's why I'm coming here telling you. So just don't give up. So from their point, it's easy to see that because they know what needs to be done. But for us, we say, well, I don't know what needs to be done. How can you be so sure I'm going to succeed? I don't even know what's going on here. I'm just struggling. But they know that we're gradually, you know, getting it, that we have to, you know, call our projections in and say that no more. Call everything home. Accept our authority. You know, they understand what the path's all about, so it's easy for them to see, you know, those who are doing it. They say, well, you're going to succeed, of course. And they're able to literally see what you're doing is going to work, and they know you're going to, they can see that you're going to succeed, no question in their mind. But for us, you know, we have, you know, grave doubts sometimes, like, what? This is just too much. I mean, what? Because we think we have to find some compromise between the personality, between two different wills, you know, as if the personality had a separate will. It doesn't. It's entirely projection. This is what we struggle with. We think that some of this is real, and some of it might be a bit projection, but we think we can get a compromise. This is the trouble, that for a while it seems compromise works great for us. But when we really want to be truly happy, then this is when the trouble arises, because we realize I can't seem to fashion a compromise that works, that'll provide what I really want. And then we really start struggling. But so ultimately you got to flip that into honoring time when you say, oh, this is just all a projection. This is why Jesus is so helpful. He said, it's all a projection. 100%. You know, his message is totally uncompromising in this way. And this is a lifesaver. A lifesaver. Otherwise, the struggle would become too much, and we'd just stop. We'd say, can't do it. Can't do it. So many of us try, and then we quit. We say, I can't do it. I can't fashion a perfect compromise. Well, of course not, because the personality doesn't have any will. It's like we're trying to fashion a compromise with something that doesn't exist. And it's baffling and bewildering to us. The personality doesn't have any will. It's a projection, thinking that if we what we project leaves us. It doesn't leave us. Our projections don't leave us. It's just we're demanding that it seem this way, but they don't. Thoughts don't leave their source. Ideas don't leave their source, actually. Just like we cannot leave God. So, when we accept it's all a projection, then there's no need for some compromise between my will and some other will. There isn't any other will. No other will at all. So then the path goes quickly, and it's not as much of a struggle, and you start having, all these breakthroughs. So when you repent and get on the path, you will have breakthroughs. But initially, of course, you're still thinking that you need to honor this compromise. But here's an important point. You don't need to honor the worshiping of time. Because the point is we need to honor time. So if we just honor time, that's it. We don't need to honor the worshiping of time. Okay, this is what gets us into trouble. The worshiping of time is really not really honoring time. It's trying to make it real. To honor something real is you realize, it's in the grave. I mean, it never had any life to it. The idea of time never had any extension to it. It cannot extend at all. So we're honoring the fact that this idea could not extend, and we're putting some creativity around it to honor it, but we understand that, this is all we're doing. Whereas worshiping, you're trying to make it real, saying, no, we can extend it. There is a way to extend it. That's not honoring time. It's not. It's in denial. It's in total denial. That's why they're trying to fashion, sisters, this other will, separate will. And trying to say, you can see time, there's a way for you to extend because there's a separate will. There isn't. There's no separate will. It's only our projections. So how can we call our projections home if we don't realize there are our projections? This is why this tiger, was such a big thing, because this is like the symbol of our entire projection, this tiger. This is like, it's all there. The whole ferocity, the strength, the determination, the cunning, the intelligence, the agility, the stealth, the majesty, the power, everything. The tiger is symbolizing that, this extraordinarily, adapted beast can land, can swim, can go on land, can climb trees, this is a symbol. So this is like the symbol of all projections coming back. And so, it overwhelmed me for a little bit there. But not for long, not for long. I got it very quickly. I knew, okay, there's got to be, let's look at it half full. And I went into the wow. I said, wow, this is great. Okay, how do we look at it as a glass half full way? And then right away, then I began to have this sort of visual imagery and dream, like, okay, come into the house. And then it all started to settle down, just like that. Now, this is not possible for those who are worshiping time. They cannot call all their projections back all at once like that. Now they're fashioning a compromise. They try to fashion a compromise, like, okay, you tiger have your own will, and I have my own will. Let's see. Let's form a truce between these two wills, and let's have peace between these two wills. This is what Jesus says doesn't work. This is very Jesus. A Course in Miracles is so important. People underestimate it to a drastic extent. Even the non-dualists underestimate it to a drastic extent. I call it the personality non-dualists. There are a lot of those. Drastically underestimated. It is just a fabulous path of rehabilitation, actually, if you really use it properly. Because it's uncompromising. There is no other will, Jesus. There is no other will. So how can you fashion a compromise between one party? You know, one will, one all-inclusive will. What is there to compromise with? But if you accept that, then you realize these are all just all projections then. Yeah, that's right. I say, well, I don't want that tiger live in my home. Well, when you bring the tiger into your home, there's nothing more for it to do. So you just say, well, just be a little inert, flat, quiet, you know, over there, just sit on the corner. That's it. So there's no more ferocity or more anything because there's no more projecting. And there's only one will. So the tiger doesn't have it. You realize there's no separate will. You can't be threatened. It's impossible to be threatened. And of course, then the continuity fears, oh my gosh, well, God will realize then if it's this dream is completely unthreatened, non-threatening, there's nothing, it's perfect, it's blissful, it's non-threatening. How can God think this is some sort of separate creation or not coming from me, you know? And God will know. Of course, God's always known. This has come from us. God says, God's not trying to tell us we can't play this way. He says, oh, you want to play this way? Okay, it's fine. It's great. Love it. Love your freedom. But if you want to set it down, that's also great. That's part of your freedom too. So God is just this perfectly supportive, you know, like this perfectly supportive parent. It's just, whatever you do, it's never wrong with me. It's always right. You have perfect standing with me. And so there's not some, God's not trying to, you know, grab us and punish. Oh, so it was you who dreamed this all along. I didn't realize that. Now I know I'm going to grab you and punish you forever. It's not like that at all. God's never been fooled. Never, never, never. Not even for an instant. Got up this morning and I took the plunge last night. Maybe that's why I had the tiger dream. I put the kale into the smoothie. Kale and spinach and chard and, you know, all these greeny greens, dandelion. I mean, this is a package of, you know, baby kale and greens. I stuffed up half a package into the smoothie. Holy cow. Not bad. Not bad. Not bad. It did blend, but you do get a little of that chlorophyll-y taste, which is okay. It was fine. But it's just the idea of drinking, you know, liquid kale. And so this morning I got up to this kale smoothie. I threw a banana in it just to try to help out a little bit. And I drank it down, and it's fine. It's good. It's just that you have to, it's acquired taste. I have to get used to it, but I'm sure it's very healthy for me. But really, maybe that's what caused the tiger dream, like I said. I said, oh my God, the kale smoothie, it's like traumatizing me. But the thing is, you know, you can, in a smoothie, you can put more kale and more of these greens than you could eat in a salad in just one smoothie. Half a package I took. Ordinarily, for a salad, I might take a quarter package at the most or something, you would think. Half a package. So I'm getting like a full salad plus enough fruits for a big fruit feast. Plus a banana, plus a protein drink, you know. So there's a lot of nutrients packed into just that smoothie. So I've already eaten my veggies for the day. They say that, you know, the spinach and the kale is like superfood. It's really good for you. So great. Maybe it'll help my eyesight. But you got to be careful. Don't make them too much of the greens or else you'll go away from it. It's too much. So just, you know, just blend it in with the sweet fruit juices and it masks the taste very, very well. You You see, we don't want the personality catered to here. Why do you think that people who are in rehab, we call spiritual, religious people, spiritual path, they're in rehab? Why do you think they're told to live simple lives? Don't go down the path of indulging the personality. This is what you came here not to do. That's why we want simple clothes here, simple living quarters, simple stuff, simple stuff. You don't want to even give the opportunity to go down those paths. You don't want these huge industries churning out all this stuff for you, tempting you. It's like an alcoholic when they go to rehab. What do they have, some like fantastic bar with great entertainment there in the rehab center? Say, oh yeah, you're here to rehab, get off alcohol. But by the way, there's this fabulous band in there and wonderful decor and seating and people are dancing and everything. And oh yeah, by the way, there's this fully stocked bar with awesome bartenders, you know, there too. But you know, don't have any of that stuff. You know, it's not good for you. I mean, this defeats the purpose of the rehab center, doesn't it? Don't you go to rehab, don't you like have, you know, kale smoothies ready for you? And you know, you work out and you go in the sauna and you drink your, you know, fruit kale smoothies, and you go to just, you know, group prayer, meditation, assertion practice, and you recover your, you know, you get your confidence back, and right, you don't have, you know, a bunch of an entertainment center with all this stuff, live band and disco queens out there saying, come on, let's dance. And the other people, they're all drinking like crazy. I mean, what kind of rehab center is that? That's a dysfunctional rehab center is what it is. This rehab center has probably become dysfunctional, severely dysfunctional. You know, if you're like a fashionista and you got this fashionista addiction, you don't go to a rehab place where the whole thing is just like one vast closet full of every kind of shoe and wardrobe, and you know, where you say, oh my God, I can't resist, I've got to try on this scarf, I got to put this thing on, I got to look at this, a makeup center, a rehab, and my hair style, beauty salons everywhere, whatever. And you don't do that. You go to a place, say, here's your habit, you know, here's your robe, here's your this is your, and you give yourself opportunity to break the habit. Yeah, you know? this is the rehab center here on this planet no longer. So what's Jesus going to do? What is Spirit going to do? I don't know, but we can, you know, start get some ideas, you know, probably, but we'll see. We have to continue our own rehab. That let the Holy Spirit worry about that other stuff, you know. But stay away from materialism. This is deadly. But we're in it, right? So you have to be very wise about it. Realize how deadly it is, and preempt it, co-opt it. Preempted, co-opted. If I can get some more trendy eco greens today, I will. Maybe I'll get, you know those sprouts that they use now. They sprout all these trendy greens, and you get them in there, just their sprouted form. I'll throw those into the smoothie too. That's what I'm gonna do. Yeah, I got a sprout smoothie. Yeah, so what's your dialogue? Oh, yeah, I've just sort of, you know, I've trended into sprout smoothies right now. You know, I'm germinating all these seeds, chia seeds and all these different mung bean seeds, and I germinate them all. Yeah, a little germinating platform, I germinate them all, and then I, you know, put them into a smoothie. Oh, wow, it's so organic. That's so holistic. That's so forward-thinking. You know, that's so indulging. The personality, your personality is going to be fabulous. You're on the path to a fabulous personality. You might even hang out in a quick smala, you know, someday. So if it's still there, nobody even knows if it's still there. I checked the news this morning. Said no reports from quick smala yet. The telephone lines are down. Well, can't they fly a helicopter, drive in there? I guess they can't drive in there, and all the roads are blocked with trees, I imagine. I mean, they don't have airplanes. There's nowhere to land out there, probably. So nobody knows what's going on in Quixmala. Crazy thing is, all these wild animals they have roaming around, do they get those wild animals to safety? This is the question, isn't it? I mean, PETA should be all over that situation. I mean, those animals may have been hit by the hurricane. I don't know. Is there some safe place they can put them? I hope so. I hope so. Because ordinarily wild animals do not live in hurricane areas like this. These are animals are from Africa, for God's sake. You got giraffes there. And giraffes, I mean, giraffes cannot handle 200 mile an hour per hour winds. You know, come on. This is something for PETA to investigate, I'm sure. They will investigate. You see, these A-listers who are encouraging everyone to indulge the personality, it gets too much for them. It wipes them out. So they go into this hideaway. They go, I'm in a, you know, again, I'm in a third world rehab center. I'm in a jungle. I've got all these wild animals around here. I'm sitting on the beach. Maybe do a little fishing on the beach. And minimize, you know, it's sort of like a primitive. It's luxurious primitivism is what it is. And they hang out there for a couple of weeks, a month or so. So then they can go back to the world and get on stage. Say, hey, everybody, indulge the personality. Look at me. I'm a trashy whore. You know, this is what you need to be. And, it's revolting to them. I mean, a lot of their children, they don't raise their children, for, you know, these pop stars, rock stars, you know, they shield their children from all the stuff. They never, you know, they don't take them to their concerts or involve them with that stuff. They know it's toxic, but, you know, this is what they're doing. So they flee to these primitive, exotic, primitive, you know, luxurious primitivism is what they do, and they let the personality, you know, calm it down so they can go back and make, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars more, leading everybody down the primrose path in the wrong direction. But if it weren't for these getaways, you know, they would collapse. You know, it's too toxic for them. Being a cheerleader for the personality is very toxic. Wipes you out. That's why so many of them have drug addictions, severe drug addictions and suicides and troubles. It's awful. This is why they have enough money, they flee to these places. And they don't want anybody around. They just want to hunker down on a beach, you know, and just stare at the water and the sand. Which is, again, what I say, is rehabilitative, third world rehabilitativism. They don't want any technology around. You know, they want it primitive. They want it very primitive. Because only that calms them down. Yeah, calms. They flee the world like this way, then go back to it and pump it up again. You know, that's not real spirituality. The enlightenment is here now. It's wherever you are, you carry a portable paradise with you, actually. It's a different thing. Now, you may go to places that are nice retreats to highlight them for people. You can go here and detox. But the emphasis is on spiritual path, not going back to the world and saying, okay, now I've recharged my batteries. Now I'm going to be even more of a cheerleader for the personality. Intense sneeze just tried to get hold of me, just suddenly, boom. Wow. So, retreats are not for the purpose of kind of recharging batteries to go back and you know, be a bigger cheerleader. That's not what it's about at all. It's to get comfortable with not doing that. Saying, hey, I can do this. I can do the rehab. I've got a road of rehab ahead of me. And just enjoy the rehab. I mean, it's glass half full. You know, we don't have to try to fake it in terms of it's difficult. You know, the idea that the personality presents with these princesses prancing around, like, oh, I'm so happy, I'm so free, I'm so wonderful, this, I'm just loving, this is great. It's a false image. It's a false image. Because then when you, that doesn't happen for you, you go over the personality, because they're really, they're, this personality spirituality is what they're doing, a lot of them. And it, rehab is difficult. It's stressful. It's a strain. The continuity fear is a strain. You know, the wow is a strain. It's a bit of a strain. Absolutely it is. These dreams that come up, you know, are shocking, because it puts you on the spot. And it's positive, like I say, positive trauma. So it's traumatic, but positively traumatic. It's not all this lip gloss and shiny hair and laughing and smiling, you know, it's kittenish stuff. No, it's not like that. Often you see the people are very serious and glum. I have been most of my rehab. This is brutally difficult. Wow, I'm struggling so bad. Yeah, that's okay. If you see the real teachers, the apparent, the way they express, we assume it's a personality. It's not. It's just personality is just an empty shell for, you know, for them. They're not projecting, but to relate to us, they seem to have some sort of relational capacity. It's not all this ebullient, kittenish, sort of let's all prance around and go to resorts and be happy. Sort of this spirituality is making me so happy. It's not like that at all. It's not like that at all. They tend to be quiet, they tend to be peaceful, they can laugh some, they can smile some, they seem to be serious a lot of the time. They have good humor, but there's this calmness, you know, it's not the personality, is it? It's not the personality. So the idea that the personality is going to have fun in rehab is not true. Because the personality is not in charge of spirit. And spirit is struggling, struggles with rehab. You see those around the great sages, oftentimes they're quite, you know, serious. They're not saying, oh, let's party, fiesta. All night long. Who did that? Oh, that's Lionel Richie or something, right? Yeah, fiesta, come on, party, fiesta. It's not like Super Bowl, you know. Come on, we're having a great time on this path. We're just dancing around, and this is awesome. You know, this attracts the personality. This attracts the personality. Now, A Course in Miracles had to have some, you know, interface with the personality belief. Okay, so it's this path is a happy path. Okay, right. But it also says, not, as Jesus puts it in there, that it's very difficult. You'll have ups and downs. You'll be a stall out. You'll have plateaus. It can seem very frustrating. You know, it's quite, you know, it's in there. But there is some of that personality-ness to get it going, you know, apparently in this world, especially in these times where we're so addicted to the personality idea. Of worshiping time, we're such insane time worshippers that you can't just bring something that's completely based on honoring time, and that's all it, you know, that you got to put a little frame around it. The content of A Course in Miracles is totally honoring time, no compromise, there is no separate will whatsoever. But the framework around it has a little bit of, you know, flowers in it and stuff, personality stuff, so people can feel, oh, yeah, personality can feel a little bit attracted to it. If that's all it is, then it's just become just it just remains superficial. They're just dilettantes, and you see a lot of that going on, and maybe after, that's a phase they go through, and then after a while they stop that and they start getting more serious. That's very possible. So at first it's like, oh, this is fun. Look at me, you know, I can be really beautiful and have a beautiful personality and be spiritual too. Awesome. And then later on they say, wow. Maybe that's not it. change. So that's how it goes. That's how it goes. Yeah, the real, again, we're such time worshipers now. Intense that to be helped. We have to be told this is that can be a happy path for us. You know, oh, joy, joy, happy, happy. Personality is going to be really happy. Well, the spirit's not going to be happy with a happy personality. I can tell you that, you know. The spirit's got to call its projections home. And that's very frightening. You know, it's a struggle. Continuity fear struggle. Continuity fear has got to be dealt with one way or the other. There's no way around it. No way around it. Now, glass half full means there's a willingness to see it in a positive way. That's a different story. This helps you get the tough work done. That's not to say that the work isn't difficult. It's very difficult. But when you see it in the right way, it becomes a lot easier. You do it faster. But like the trauma of this dream, you know, I can't put the genie back in the bottle. It's a very traumatic dream. I feel exhausted. You know, it's ruined my day, so to speak. I mean, I can hardly function. I'm sluggish. I used to be this way all the time. I still am a lot of the time because it's a strain. You're not going to be prancing up on stage, you know, being some rock star when you're on the path. It's way too difficult for that. It takes all your energy and effort. You don't have the nerve left over to be some pop star. No way. That's what my personality wanted to do. That's the personality, you know. If I would have gone the personality path, that's what I would have done. What a disaster that would have been. I'd be hanging out at Quixmala. Absolutely. If I'd have kept going on the path of, you know, personality, worshiping time, absolutely I would have been there. Hanging out with Mick and the boys, you know. And yeah, we're pop stars. We're rock stars, you know. Got the world by the tail. But you can't do both. Cannot do both. So if you try to do both, you're gonna fail at both. Okay, you're going to fail at both. If you really want to be the top of the poppermost, you have to go all in with the personality. If you really want to call your projections home and honor time fully, then you cannot be a rock star at all. You'll fail. You'll fail at that for sure. And you know, dreams die hard. The fear, we keep thinking, no, I got to get some compromise. There's got to be some will out there, you know. Otherwise, God will realize this is all for me. I have to say, no, no, no. Some of these things are real, God. They're not my projections. There is some will out there. Nature has a will. Come on, God. You know, so we keep wanting to, you know, make us compromise. There's only one will. I am that will. I am that will. I am that one will. If there's only one will, I have no choice but to be that will, right? There's only one will and there's no other will. There's nothing, no separate will. There's just one will and none other than that. No other. So I have to be that will. We all have to be that will. We are the one will. So let's say I am the one will. I am the perfect will. This is true, right? If there's only one will, how could we not be that one will? Everything runs up. Everything is God's will. And that's only God's will. So I must be God's will too. I must be that. I am that. No choice in the matter. So it takes a lot of guts to have that dream. And I've been aiming for it. I said, look, whatever it takes, God, I'll do it. We got to do it fast here. And I said that, I prayed, I said, I'm ready for, you know, a big, big wow, whatever it is, let it be, I'll go suffer the trauma, whatever it is, and son of a gun, you know, It happened. And I suffered the trauma of it, no question. But I'm fine, you know, I'll bounce back from it. And I'm still suffering from it, no doubt about it. When you think you're about ready to be devoured by a tiger, that's not a pleasant, you know, experience. You know, it's this helpless, horrible, traumatic feeling. The tiger's about to eat me alive. I was defenseless, completely defenseless. Completely defenseless. Because I forgot I was just there to open the door for the tiger. You know, that slipped my mind in the intensity of the moment. So, yeah, it's a matter of your willingness to say, okay, now I'm ready for the next big wow. And then, you know, you'll have it. And it'll takes you a while to, you know, calm down from that wow. So it takes enormous willingness to experience something like this I experienced. I mean, it's preparation. You can't take without tremendous preparation and on the path, and without that you cannot experience such a dream like this, because you would not be willing to bring that tiger to your door. You'd say, keep on wandering. Find some happiness. There must be someone out there to make you happy. It must be something, you know. Go out and find it. So you won't bring it to your door. So you won't experience this type of dream. Certainly not at the level I experienced it, very close to the surface here, so I'm fully conscious of it, you know. Maybe you might have a deep dream at night, and some deep nightmare that you might forget pretty quickly. So you're still worshiping time, so that it's still buried in terms of time in your psyche, you know. But the thought is it's emerging, like, hey, maybe I can do this, but I'm too scared to really let it surface completely, you know. So I want to have a lot of distancing from it, time, space, process, and form, you know, defensive distancing from it. So you might experience these traumatic things in a deeper, you know, more distant type of way. But I experienced it right on the surface here. Very, 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 very much on the surface. So the trauma, you know, it's still reverberating with me, you know, very consciously here. And be able to work with it, you know, full awareness of the whole situation. This is ultimately what we're aiming for. And it's not too bad at all, you know. It's like drinking a kale smoothie. You know, I think it's going to be terrible, but it's not that bad. Yeah. What's bad is the roads here. The driving. That's what's bad. Last week I had two cars change lanes when I was right in the lane where they were trying to change into. They never even saw me. They just pulled over. Ran me off the road. Some old lady ran me off the road onto a shoulder coming off a freeway exit. She just decided to go right into me. And then another instance, again, somebody simply turned right into me and I had to swerve. Honk the horn. And so people are so frazzled and that their attention is so absorbed by all the traffic that they can't drive functionally very well anymore in terms of they can't do everything, you know. You really need to be a young person to handle this traffic. Even then, it's a great stress on them too. If you're an older person, it can be overload because it's just too much input happening too fast. And so you say, oh, I got to get over. My gosh, you know, I'm stuck in traffic, got to get over. And they just, you know, they do a quick look in the mirror or something or whatever, and then they start getting over. Now, I'm just as guilty as anybody else. I mean, we're all struggling with this. So you're driving. You can't trust the drivers around you anymore because you think they might not even bother to even look hardly or cursory, or they're not sure. They're thinking about all this other stuff. So you have to drive very defensively right here, right now, very defensively. And that's, you know, this is a real drag. I'm telling you, real drag. It's like you don't want to drive at all. There again, helping, you know, erode the personality, right? Personality says, I want to go places, I want to do stuff, I want to go shop. And they say, no, are you kidding me? I mean, going out on a weekend, here, everybody goes out, you know, and it's terrible. Like, it's the only time to go out, like Sunday evening or something, you know. But I have to drive in it every day, all the time. Yeah, it's terrible. Hurts the personality. Personality says, how can I go places and do everything? How can I be king of the road, you know, and when the situation is going on? And then if someone has to pull out from a parking lot and it's just gridlock, and you say, oh gosh, they're going to be stuck there forever. So I say, okay, well, I'll let them in. You know, this is the way I am. I'll just say, okay, here, come on. But then the people behind me, you know, they're all upset because they're not going to get through the light for two or three changes. And they say, doggone it. So I let them in, then we go, and I go through the light, and they don't. You know, like, they're furious, you know, don't let them in. What are you doing? You're slowing me down. So you can't really be civil. If you're civil, it's damned if you didn't. Damn if you do, damn if you don't. If you're civil to people, other people get upset with you. If you're not civil, someone gets upset with you. You get upset with yourself, saying, why am I being so mean like that? I'm being uncivil that way. So you're really caught between a rock and a hard place. And the personality, everyone's a personality cult. Silicon Valley's a personality cult. And boy, you know, they want it now. They want it all, and they want it now. And they're getting really, really, really frustrated. You know, it's just like a collective exercise in frustration here. There may be a lot of need for massive psychotherapy in the Silicon Valley soon. But you're getting people coming in from all around the world who lived in big cities, and they're used to all the traffic and stress and strain and everything. And they just, you know, it doesn't bother me, you know. So they're functioning better here. You get better here than Americans. We're not really used to this here in this area. No, it's freaking us out. Don't like it. We're used to being king and queen of the road here. I used to be, you know, I mean, personality indulgence. Get in your big old Cadillac or Lincoln Continental and cruise down the open highway, and, you know, you're just absolutely ruling the road. Even better, convertible caddy. Leather everything, you know, and just, you know, 457 or some gigantic engine, maybe a 5.2 liter engine or whatever they call it, massive V8, gas is 20 cents a gallon or something, and, you know, you're just cruising to Arizona. I mean, this is great. You own the road. This was America. You own the road. Personality paradise, America. No longer. It's a personality nightmare now. Great opportunity for spiritual enlightenment for a little while. The other problem is everybody's freaking out and saying, my gosh, we got to work out even harder to make it a personality paradise. It's slipping away. Let's double our efforts. You see, this is the problem now. Is we're feeling like, hey, it's not a personality paradise anymore. What do we do? What do we do? What do we do? You know, oh my gosh, we got to work harder at it. Everybody's got to double down. The whole world, let's double down. We're losing this personality paradise. You know, we got to make it work. This is what the problem that Jesus sees, I believe, sees. This is the huge problem. Because this is what we'll get sucked into, the whole world. And we don't want that. We want rehab. We want to call our projections back home. So this is the trouble, as we lose this feeling of being king of the road, which, of course, again, America was the personality paradise in the world, especially California. We didn't have the traffic before. I mean, you just cruise. Everybody's happy. Let's just cruise down to, 17-mile drive. Have a picnic on the beach. Everybody's happy. They're all say, wow, look at us. We're so fortunate. We're all in personality paradise here. Everybody's lost just in the how fortunate they are to, to have this personality paradise. Now, by the time you get there battling everybody else, you're just completely frazzled. You look at the beach, I don't have time to get home. Oh my God, how long is it going to take me to get home? 3 or 3.5 hours. Which route do I go? Let me take a look at GPS. Where's the traffic? Is there an accident there? Oh my God, it's going to take me 4 hours. If I don't get stuck, I run out of gas, I'm only going 2 miles an hour. It's hell. It's hell. It's personality hell now. And yet, they're doubling down on it, of course. And of course, the techies say, don't worry. We'll fix it all. We'll make it more organized. You'll have your GPS to tell you where the bottlenecks are. But how does that help us when everywhere is a bottleneck? What's the GPS going to do then? How helpful will it be then? You look at the routes. What route do I take? They're all completely backed up. Well, then your GPS will tell you, well, there is a good bread and breakfast just 2.5 miles from here. Turn right and make another left, and there's a really nice bed and breakfast there. It's got nice rate. Yelp gives it a 4.5 star rating, and it's only $350 a night. Why don't you spend another evening down here, and don't worry about the traffic? And you say, okay, great, this is awesome. It's working for me. It's working. There's all this technology is working for me now. So you go to the bed and breakfast. You pay a fortune, or you miss work, get more, and say, okay, now we can drive home. Then you check your GPS. Oh my God, it's still bottled up. There's an accident there. Oh, this is hell. I'm back in hell again. And the computer will tell you, why don't you spend a second night? You can actually get a discount, Look into that. Oh, yeah, but I got to earn some money to do all this. And so, we keep thinking the computers are going to give us the answer, to how to keep experiencing this as a personality paradise. And, the computers will keep running out of answers. So we keep saying, well, come on, techies, better gadgets, because that's the answer, better gadgets. I mean, I don't know. Is there some sort of gadget that can take the cars off the road? Maybe the hackers will start hacking cars, make them so they don't work. So I don't want all these people on the road. Let me just hack all the computer systems of the cars so they don't work. Probably will come to that. Get to the beach, Ocean Beach, San Francisco. Oh, finally got to the beach. It's great. Oh, gee, but the radioactive content is a little too high. I'm going to get zapped. I better not stay here. Yeah, all these apps, all this stuff, it's all about the personality. How can I, I'm talking to people and say, they're taking all the back roads now. So I got a back road. I got a way to get home fast. Nobody knows about this road. It's back in the mountains, Well, guess what? Everybody else is going to find out about it very soon. Gridlock there too. They're building like crazy still here. I mean, it's not stopping. So it's just going to get exponentially worse, and the people are going to lose their minds. And they're taking drugs, they're taking anxiety, anti-this, like crazy. Everybody's medicated just to handle it. They say, oh, that's okay, it's worth it now. And then what happens is those with the money, they just flee the area. They just take vacations like crazy. It's the only way to handle it. If you don't have the money, you're stuck. You're in hell. Of course, you have to keep earning that money, and everybody else is desperately competing with you to earn that money. To take the vacations. And of course, taking vacations is getting more and more difficult. The airports are getting more and more crowded. The security situations are a nightmare. Travel's getting, it's not getting easier really. It's getting more difficult, more trying, more taxing, more expensive. You go to other places, they're gridlocked too. Welcome to personality hell. Okay, and if there's not genuine repentance and great faith in the great sages, then we keep doubling down on more research. We need more research. We need to find out what, you know, how we can be sustainably happy in this personality paradise, and, you know, figure out better systems, and so it's not so clogged, and we got to get better gadgets. Why don't you sit home and watch television? We got 1,000 channels of horror films for you to watch. Or just eat food. Sit at home and eat food. Oh, you're obese and overweight. Well, you know, go to the gym. Well, it's real crowded and not well, you know, go to yoga class then. And so we're trying to figure out, you know, how to be happy. And for those who native Californians and second and third generation ones whose parents, grandparents also, you know, lived the life here. I mean, this is hell compared to what it was. It's now a dystopian hell compared to what it used to be. You know, we used to think that we had found it because we found personality paradise. Well, we had, but there is no personality, actually. There is no personality paradise. It's an illusion. But yeah. Just like down people in the Florida Keys, you know, various places, they think, I found it. Until everybody starts pouring in. We have people now pouring in here from everywhere in the world. Everybody's trying to get here. Pay any price because they think this is where I'm going to be happy. This is where I'm going to earn the money to be happy. Their plan is to retire in their 30s, you know. So they just intensely come in here and work, and stock. And they think that then they're going to hang out in Cuixmala for the rest of their lives, you know, retire in their 30s at some point, and then hang out and be happy, you know. So they're frantically working to get that. Startup, you know. push. Use up your youth that way. Use up all that intensity you could have used on the spiritual path, you see. You need that vitality and that bounce backness and that youthful confidence, and you need that intensity, all that stuff. You need that on the spiritual path. If you use it all up and you burn it all out, by the time you hit 50, 60, how can you get started? How can you get started? I got started from day one here, but really, you know, full on in, you know, early 20s, 20, 21, 22, like that, full on. So I used this whole time of you know, intense career, you know, the ability to make an intense push on a career. I used to put all of it into the spiritual path, all of it. But if you put all of it into just trying to make a fortune so you can hang out in Cuixmala, primitive personality resort, you know, luxury primitive personality resort, you know, you'd just be hanging out there burned out. Just an idiot. Can't make the push. Because the spiritual path initially, with all these compromise issues you're struggling with, you know, it seems just like this massive, massive undertaking, like a massive pilgrimage, a massive, and, you know, it's like climbing, you know, the Himalayas times a million, you know. But so you're gearing up for it, you're working out, you're going there, you know. It's a huge challenge, massive challenge. But when you're young, you say, okay, let me take it on. But when you're old and burned out from trying to be a billionaire, you're not going to have the juice to take on a massive challenge like that. So you say, I'll pay somebody else. Oh, I got billions. I'll pay somebody else to do it for me. It's okay. Nobody can call your own projections home. Everyone has to call their own projections home. Nobody can do it for them. So with a rehabilitative planet, the youth have to be guided into the spiritual path. Use your intensity there. Don't try to build up some elaborate personality paradise. This is an extraordinarily bad misdirection. You know, in the past he had dirt roads. I mean, the Romans put stone roads down. But let them be. They're good for thousands of years. Dirt road? You know, walk the dirt road, walk, ride a mule, ride a horse or whatever, but don't build up some super personality, superstructure in the world. Let it be simple. Don't try to create a dynasty with your family. Don't try to start a dynasty. Keep it all simple. So a personality paradise is really a spiritual hell. I mean, it severely mitigates against putting all our efforts on the spiritual path. We think that we can just dabble in it like dilettantes. And there's no way that works. And of course, in a personality paradise, they say, don't worry, we'll take care of the spiritual path with drugs. Just use these drugs, and that'll do it for you. Doesn't work that way. That creates dissociation. Absolutely. Which then is even, you know, which feeds right into the belief in compromise. Feeds right into the belief in compromise. Dissociation, compromise, right? So you see at some level, some spirituality through drugs, you seem to see something. And then you say, well, I got the personality too, so how do I integrate the two? And you get, then there's this inherent dissociation which you try to bridge through, you know, personality indulgence and working on compromises. And you know, the whole economy is now centered on all this, so even the retreats, spiritual retreats, will be turned into these, you know, eco-personality retreats. That's where the money is. That's the people who are going with the money. That's what they want. There's no more money in genuine spiritual retreats that I'm aware of, really. I don't know. It doesn't seem that way. You get all this trendy architecture and make the personality happy. Let the personality realize, you're going to be coddled here too. Don't worry. We got a compromise here. This is what we're teaching. We're smarter. We know that the compromise, they say, is the way. And you can have our cake and eat it too. There is another will. We're going to have two wills. And we'll integrate those two wills. That's not it at all. That's the anti-path. For those who have really put all their effort into the spiritual path, this is a very great time right now. Very great time, because the pressure's on. And so we're willing to take risks, which I did with this dream I had. There's no question. You know, I sort of gave up a day here, you know, feeling shocked. I give up every day that way, basically. I always feel terrible because I'm pushing so fast. But this one, you know, really hit hard. And so but you can do that. You can say, what's worth it? You know, what else am I going to do? There's a nightmare here. All these little towns, in America where the church isn't so big anymore. People, young people are saying, oh, I'm missing out on so much personality fun. What is this church? This is ridiculous. I don't need rehab. I need fun. They're hanging out in these little towns. There's nothing to do. So they use drugs. They just go to methamphetamine. Make them feel like there's, you know, super people. It's got superpowers. And everything seems fabulously interesting from the personality angle. And, you know, it's a devastating epidemic. Countryside's been devastated by methamphetamine. You don't see it so much here in the cities. It's mostly the countryside. They get tired of shooting at tin cans, you know, make it funner for them. They go on meth and go on some, you know, survival quest or something. Go out in the jungle and with knives and go out in the forest or something and you know, go hunting. I don't know, it just makes I guess them feel like they can, you know, tackle the tiger. Go hunt the tiger. Instead, you know, they're hunting the tiger instead of inviting the tiger back home. You know, this is the difference, right? We're trying to make our projections happy. No, you're not a projection. You're natural, your nature. Stay there. You can be happy that way. Not realizing this is all a mental projection of spirit. Not of a human body or something, of spirit. Spirit's projecting all this. The world. How's my pine cone doing? This is, it's mildewing. Pine nuts are all mildewing. Typical of the world, right? Everything mildews here. I should put it out in the sunlight so it dries out and maybe I can eat the, actually in nature it would split apart and it'd all dry out, but I'm keeping it together here so it's mildewing in there. Wow. Bunyan pine, yeah, it's all coming apart. It's all mildewing in there. Yep. Isn't that interesting? Bunya pine cone. Wonder if Paul Bunyan came from that bunya. Super big pine cone. I thought, hey, Paul Bunyan, super big guy. I said, people take methamphetamine, they think they're Paul Bunyan. Go across the countryside in a few steps. So this kind of shock, it takes a while. You can't force it. It takes a while to calm down from this. So even though I'm working through, it's still there. So what we do is have gratitude for the tiger. Thank you, tiger, for coming back home, for recognizing my signals. Thank you so much. I'm very, very grateful. Sorry that I got startled like that. It's not your fault. I had a momentary lapse. But welcome home. Thanks so much for coming back home. I'm so grateful and appreciative of this. You know, try to take that sort of tact. I'm so glad you're so attentive to catch my clue. I gave you a little clue. You saw it. You came here. You saw the clue. You came up to me. Wonderful. Thank you so much for that. Is awesome. Very great. And at some point we'll celebrate. Right now, I'm still a little jittery at my my little lapse there. But you're gonna lapse in a situation like that. It's so intense. You see, the thing was, I was still looking for a compromise there in the dream. But I didn't have any. Nothing came to mind. And that then enabled me then to realize, oh, I'm called the tiger here to let them in my house. But initially, I was thinking, the tiger's going to eat me. What do I do? I said, okay, I got to think of a compromise here. I got to say something to the tiger. And nothing came to mind. No words came to mind. And that's when I thought, I'm going to be eaten, because I couldn't think of any compromise. But instead of being eaten, I enter Eden, you know, not Eden, even Eden. But come on in, lion, tiger, lie down with the lamb. This is it, all the projections lie down together, all flattened out. This is what Jesus says, the lion will lie down with the lamb. There's a spiritual condition he's talking about. That's what happened. I had no compromise. I had no compromise. So that's why I suddenly got real frightened. I kept thinking, what am I going to say? What am I going to say? When? And I said, I know I'll come up with something. I know I'll be able to protect myself somehow. And I couldn't do it. There's nothing there. So we're scared to really do the spiritual path and see through this, because then we'll lose all faith in compromises. So when this dream happens, there's no compromises there anymore. You've just dropped them. But paradoxically, that works in our favor. Initially, we have a trauma, like, oh my gosh, I don't have any compromises. And then we realize, I don't need any, because now I see what the tiger's here for. It's not here to eat me. It's here to come into the home and lie down in peace. And leave me in total peace is what it's really here for. Once all the projections have been called home, then there's the peace, total peace. Peace in your home. They're all there just enchanted by the absolute peace and the one will. It's difficult to relate with people, for me on the personal level anymore, because I don't have any strategies anymore. And they're all about strategies and how, you know, how they're going to pamper the personality. You know, I don't have a clue. I have nowhere to go, nothing. I don't have any ideas at all. So just like, what are you? You know, I don't want that. Don't want to hang around that. And so you tend to lose your friends in terms of, you know, the personality, the folks, you know. Things that you used to do, you know, you don't do them anymore. There, go, 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 go. I say, I'm not going to go where? What do you mean? I've been there, done that. I'm not going there anymore. That wasn't it. All this brainwave monitoring, all this, the tech stuff they're doing, it's all personality stuff. Doesn't have anything to do with salvation at all. False path. But there's endless elaborations, you know, on it. They can keep themselves busy for a long time. Chasing the holy grail of making time real. Beautiful day today. You can feel the air is getting cooler. October 25th. Headed towards the 27th, one of my favorite days. Historically, A little leaf showed up here. Just blew in. The breeze just blew in a leaf on the computer. Nice. Green leaf. Interesting. So the leaf is no longer on the tree. It's no longer a projection. But it's still green, meaning it's not showcasing death. Interesting. Detachment from the personality. I mean, it's not detachment. You see, detachment is a misleading term. Very misleading. We think we're supposed to detach from our projections. No, 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 no. We call them home. Say thank you for coming home. And they thank us. Say thank you for calling me home, you know. I hate wandering out there. And it's all just us. It's just a projection of us that we think is separate from us. It's not. So it's all just a matter of thanking ourselves, really. But we kind of go through the motions as if, you know, thank you, thank you. That's fine. We don't need to detach from the world. We need to call the world home. Come on into my house. Plenty of room. Call the whole world home, actually. When we call all our projections home, then ultimately we realize the whole world is also just a projection, too. Like a stage that we, you know, that helps us stage this dream. So ultimately we can call the entire world home as just a projection. Maybe that's next. I don't know. Possible. Little leaf, nice little leaf. I don't know where it came from, but it must have come from that tree up there. Yeah. Okay. Another thing, being poor is a big help, because you can't indulge the personality then. Like, I can't do anything hardly. Occasionally, I know I'm trying to play golf, but. You know, even that's a, you know, ridiculous strain as far as financially, and I can't do anything hardly at all. It's very helpful. Can't indulge the personality. Personality would love to do all sorts of stuff. Well, used to. Now it's just I say, forget it. Yeah, but oh yeah, let's go here. Let's go here. Let's go here. I mean, again, most people go leave town every weekend. You know, is a lot. Those who are in the know is where to go. And, others go shopping, which is why it's so crowded here. They go shopping, but, you know, everybody, the problem is getting out of town, and everybody's getting out of town. It's crazy. You get on the freeways out of town, it's gridlocked there, too. And coming back home on Sunday, it's a nightmare. So, you know, you just can't escape it. But they're trying to, you know, have fun. We used to go surfing all the time. You know, I could just, like, whatever, it's like sitting here, like, what do I do? How to make the personality happy? I want to have a happy day. Oh. Let's get in the car. Let's go surfing. Let's go to the beach. Go surfing. Which is, of course, a great adventure for the personality. We could just do whatever we wanted to. Yeah, then the surf spots start getting real crowded. Now, Santa Cruz is an absolute nightmare. It's the traffic there is worse than here. It used to be Santa Cruz was the getaway from, you know, the intrusion of upon our personality paradise. It was the personality paradise place. It's laid back, and you know the personality felt like it just owns the place. This is great. Now, it's just an incredible nightmare traffic-wise there. Super expensive, even more expensive there here. So, it's turned into a nightmare Santa Cruz area. The wealthy, the real wealthy people still, like the Carmel Valley, you know, which is, that too is built up, but they, there's, you know, that there's still areas that they can, you know, hold it down a little bit, but Carmel's very busy right now too. I mean, the shopping's frantic. People leave the Silicon Valley, go down Bay Area, go down to Carmel, shop, think it'll be better, and shop. And people are, you know, there's so much wealth here in Silicon Valley that people can shop. This is a drastic personality detour, shopping. I haven't shopped in a long time. I got some golf clubs re-gripped when I was there about 10 minutes. There were some just close-out items there, and I grabbed a jacket, boom, and left. That's it. That's my shopping. First thing I've bought in a long, long time. So that's a heavy, heavy personality activity, shopping. And with disposable income, people, you know, they love the shop, and the shops cater to that, right? Of course. And look at all this trendy, lovely stuff, and you can buy. It becomes a severe addiction, actually. Severe addiction. How many marriages are broken up over this addiction? Where one of the spouses is a shopaholic. Oftentimes the wife, she sits at home. If she doesn't have a job, what she does, she wants to go shopping. They want to sit at home all day watching the television, go shopping. Big problem. It becomes a severe addiction, actually. Really intense addiction, because you combine the shopping with espresso, with caffeine, you know, and go shop for a while, go to Starbucks, have an espresso, and then go shop some more, and that tends to fuel shopping, you know. Caffeine tends to fuel the personality intensely. So if I can go shop all day, I feel like, oh, I'll buy this. I was listening to some music recently. I was in some establishment, I don't remember where it was, but oh my gosh, and it was the golf store where I actually did buy something, and I listened to all this music that they're piping in there, and I realized this music is custom tailored to get you to buy stuff. I saw the connection, you know, between pop music. Popular music is really there's a corporate formula really for it. It's purposeful, and it's basically saying, hey, if you're sexy enough, I'm available, kind of thing. But it's, and then you think, oh wow, how do I be sexy enough? Oh, look at this, you know, clothes. Oh, look at this, wow, I look great in this. And then you buy it. This is pop music. Hey, if you're sexy enough, I'm available. And this is what's piped in to all these stores. Actually, this is the message that's being given out. The songs are picked for that reason. And it goes both ways, right? And the personality says, this is how I have fun. This is how I enjoy myself. This is how I escape that dreadful other will, the spirit that's trying to drag me back into rehab. I don't want to go back into rehab. I want to have some fun. And I heard the music, I recognized the reaction, I saw the psychology, I was able to see it. I said, oh my God, that's what's really going on. This is, wow. Before, I'd just be irritated, but I couldn't quite see what it really is about. And then I saw how effective it is too. Very effective. I actually bought something. It may have been a personality thing that I bought, but it may have been something just to reassure people that, you know, it's not like we're trying to attack the personality here. We're calling it home as a projection. So we're not in some sort of attack mode. This is very wrong. The personality, spiritual person, personality, spirituality usually ends up saying we need to attack the ego. The ego's this vicious, terrible thing. I've got to attack it, got to destroy it, got to dissociate from it, got to detach from it, all the, you know, as if it's some separate will out there, you know, and it isn't. What we really need to do is call it back home. Call our projections back home. So I got something that is a, you know, it's a nod. As in, when in Rome, do as Romans do. Everyone's crazy about personality worshiping. Say, okay, you know, I'll wear something that people will at least make him feel a little comfortable, like, oh, he's not out to, you know, try to kill the personality, kill the ego stuff. Kill the ego. What is that? Kill the ego. That's personality, spirituality. No, yeah, I wasn't there to kill the tiger. Of course, this is what was being projected onto the tiger from me, you know. So I said, the tiger's out to kill me. No, that's because I was projecting my own still residue of needing to kill the ego or you know, whatever. But it's that was so minimal that I was able to get past it. And I said, no, come on, okay. Yeah, now I get it. Come on here, come on home, welcome home. Great to have you here. So this kill the ego thing is not a good thing at all. It's very bad. Now, some of the people studying non-dualism at this time, will go back, you know, 1,000 years ago, 2,000, whatever, ancient time, and, you know, the rishis, non-dual rishis, and they give out this stuff, and it's just like very direct and, you know, straight rehab talk. And then they compare A Course in Miracles to that and say, oh, A Course in Miracles is very dualistic, blah, blah, blah. No, A Course in Miracles is helping those here now who are extraordinarily into personality, time worshiping, and personality cult. And so you have to meet them, you know, you have to meet them halfway. You got to at least extend an olive branch and say, you know. So they're not understanding the context of the times when they criticize it. You take that just cut and dried ancient rehab talk, try to bring it into this world, and good luck with that. No way. No way is that going to work. So you just end up remaining a stale spiritual academic if you do it that way. So Jesus does talk about how terrible the ego is and all the defenses and all this kind of stuff. And so you get the idea that the ego is this terrible, hideous monster. But then he starts saying, well, you know, it's really just a collection of all your defenses. And your defenses are really just a collection of all your projections. And then you really have to forgive yourself. So, you know, he works you through it. But you got to get going first. So if he comes in and says, you know, that says, doesn't cater at all to the times, this is going to be ineffective. It's just like the main dish is the same. It's just, what are the hors d'oeuvres? Right? If you just plop the main dish down for everybody right now, everybody says, I'm not eating that. So first you give some hors d'oeuvres. You're like, oh, I kind of like this, I kind of like that. And then you lead you into the main dish, and you look at the main dish, yeah, that looks pretty good. I'll try that. I'll try some of that. So it is not dualistic. Those who say The Course in Miracles is dualistic, they don't know what they're talking about. They're missing the bigger picture. They're missing the pragmatism of rehab. This is a rehab center, this world. It's not some idealistic spiritual place. It's a rehab center for those who are severely trapped in the idea of two wills and compromise and belief of catering to the personality, etc. So you got to do some outreach to these people. You don't just say, take it or leave it. This is the dry, dusty bones of it all, and take it or leave it. No, this is rehab. This is compassionate rehab here. That's why Ananda, my mom, would agree with everything. Whatever you say, she says, all right with me. It's all equally fine, you know. Whatever you want to believe is fine with me. And so it's very nice hors d'oeuvres, you know. She gave out such nice hors d'oeuvres. But, of course, the main meal was the same main meal, right? The non-dual main meal. The main course, the entree, is the same. But very, very nice little delicacies for the you know, the hors d'oeuvres. The antipasta. And so she would just agree, you know, with everyone and say, oh, yeah. Sure. And then she'd say, yeah, that's great. And they'd feel, okay, great. She's not going to attack my position or anything. And then she'd have some way of saying, you know, and then, you know, there's also, I also encourage you to look at it this way, too. You could also look at it this way, too. And this and this and this. And they say, and why don't you give that as also for my sake? You know, I treated you so nice meal. Could you look at it that way, too, a little bit, too? And what do you think about that? And then they'd say, huh, well, yeah, maybe I will look at that a little bit. Yeah. So in other words, start eating the entree. Just a little bit. Just take a little nibble. How about a little nibble of the entree? This is wise pragmatism. And the personality, of course, got it all wrong. They say, oh, she's some, you know, miracle working goddess type of thing. You know, or No. Non-dual teacher. Some non-dual teachers live in a palace, okay? And they invite all those that want help, you know, encouragement, to come to the palace. They have servants, they have luxury, they live in that. And what happens is that those who are really advanced students coming, they end up seeing through this whole thing and say, oh, it's no big deal at all, really. So in other words, the person, they realize that doesn't satisfy the personality. Nothing satisfies the personality. It's a projection. There's no separate will, some separate ego persona that can be satisfied. It's all a projection of spirit, and spirit has to be satisfied. There's no compromise possible. But they find out by seeing the jewelry, the beautiful in decor, you know, all this luxury, and they just say, so what, you know? It's all perishable. It's, you know, it's all a projection, and it loses its grip upon them. So, you know, that has happened too. That non-dual teachers can be, you know, live in the lap of luxury that way, and invite those who want the help or capable of understanding it. They invite them into that. Drive a Rolls Royce, that's possible. Here, take a ride in a Rolls Royce, and you find out that the road's the same. You know, the world's the same. Doesn't change anything, really. It's like, wow, what a letdown. Holy cow. That doesn't mean that every teacher that drives a Rolls Royce is a genuine non-dual teacher by any means. Some of it could be personality, spirituality, absolutely. But I'm just giving you the, you know, the understandings of this, that For me, like, you know, we get a new car, get basically gifted a new car. It's like, so what? You know, it didn't have any pull on me, really. I don't feel like I have to go out there and drive it or go anywhere. Why would I want to drive anyway in this madhouse here? You know, I want to stay away from cars now. You know, get a Rolls Royce, so what? You know, drive a little bit, say, what the hell? Excuse me, what the heck? And, same traffic, same nightmare, same, you know, big deal. It's got nice leather seats. Still got to drive the doggone thing. Got to look out for maniac drivers. Does that make everyone that rode a better driver? No. Can you still find a parking space at this stupid parking lot where it's coming almost impossible? I mean, parking lots are a nightmare right now here. I'm scared to go to them. Very difficult to find parking, and everybody is frantically looking for parking. They're like sharks, you know, just and jostling, and you've got to have your head on a swivel if you go to any parking lot right now here. It's hell. It used to be just going to the store. Sure. Feel great. It's a nice little break from the house. You go out, cruise there, pull in. There's, you know, 100 parking spaces for you. Walk in leisurely, get your stuff, walk. It's fun. It's enjoyable. Now there's no parking spaces, and 100 cars looking for them, and everybody's under all this pressure. Yeah, it's terrible. Gone are the days. Good old days, is in terms of the personality, is certainly true here. So just don't go. So what good's a car? What good's a car really here? That's almost like a negative thing. Oh, I got a really nice car. Now I have to go drive it. It's almost better to say, I don't have a car, so I can't really go anywhere. You don't feel guilty about it. That's even better. So this is rehab in this world. This is what we're here for, is rehab. Not progress, blah, 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 evolution, consciousness, blah, blah, blah. No, rehab. Rehab from false belief. Rehab from worshiping, trying to worship time, trying to make time real. Rehab. So take the rehab seriously. You know, if we see a great non-dual teacher, we will say, oh my God, you know, what am I going to get hit with next? I mean, is it really a cause to celebrate in some way? But you say, uh-oh, what's next? I mean, this is really going to zap me, but after, I don't know, after, I never say never, but after experiencing that, at least not yet, after experiencing that tiger dream, you know, it's like, wow. I don't know if I can get hit by anything too much heavier than that. I should just call all the projections in home and say, okay, flatten them all out. You're just beautiful, flat decor. You know, thank you for coming back in. That's it. It's not that the end of some menagerie is hard to... No, they're all completely quiet and still. All the projections are now completely quiet and still. Ring to mind anybody? How about Ramana Maharshi? All his projections called home, completely quiet and still. Even the projection of death called home, completely quiet and still. Nanda my mom would call home all the sicknesses and illness. Come on home. Those are all projections too. Come on home, cancer. Rest with this body for a while. And then said, okay, you want to keep playing a little bit? Fine, you can leave now. But it de-intensified the cancer, actually. Great non-dual teachers like that are able to de-intensify, you know, the situation. That's why I did get severe cancer. He said, no, I'm just letting the cancer want to come and hang out with me for a while. I called this global projection home for a while. It wanted that experience, and so I'm just letting it have that experience. He says, I don't have cancer. Doctor says, your whole body's completely riddled with tumors. What are you talking about? She goes, no, nothing's wrong. He says, well, you're crazy. You gotta take morphine. She says, I don't have any pain. What are you talking about? No, this is all good. I'm enjoying this. This is wonderful. He said, well, you're going to die. You can't last a day. She says, oh, don't worry. And then it was time. The cancer said, okay, I've had enough. Thank you very much. This has really been helpful for me in terms of projection, you know, for global projection-wise. And the cancer just left. And then the next day, doctor came, and there's not a trace of cancer anywhere. Perfectly healthy. Doctor said, it's impossible. But I witnessed it. I'm seeing it. It happened. So these great teachers can allow, you know, these collective projections to hang out with them for a while, and it helps de-intensify the collective projections of the planet, actually. This is what she was doing. Which helps the overall spiritual condition of the planet, which gave us a little breathing room before this invasion took place, high-tech invasion, personality paradise invasion. These pirates who want to hang out on their little island and may turn it into a hedonistic paradise for the personality. So cancer became a little less virulent, actually. She toned down a lot of stuff. Never said what she was doing, really. People said, what are you doing? Don't worry about it. Today, don't worry about it. Just do your practicing. But why are you getting sick? Why is this stuff happening to you? Well, there's a reason, but we don't need to get into it. Yeah, even the projection of death, call that home. You don't need to kill death. We don't need to kill death. Thank it, you know, welcome home. There's only one will. Just be flat here and like inert. That too, call home all the plagues, all sicknesses. Welcome home. And then just welcome home and come on in my house, and there's only one will here. And there's only one will, that's all there is, and I know that now. So you do not represent some separate will, so welcome home. Now you're nothing but this peace, beautiful peace. And you're, you know, all the virulence is just completely inert now. Well, maybe I still have all that stuff to go. Yeah. Great. Looking forward to it. You know, if death comes to your door, say, oh my gosh, death is here at my door. It's trying to kill me. No, it's just because we called it home so you could open the door and say, come on in, welcome home. So as long as we still have this compromise, first we'll say, where's the compromise? Oh, I can't think of any. And then the projection where we need to kill death will be there. And we'll say, oh, I need to kill death. And then so death is trying to kill me because I'm trying to kill it. And I don't have any compromises. Oh my gosh, I'm going to die. This is the reaction that will come up. But if we just say, ah, thank you, death, so much for answering my call and coming on home. I'm so tired of projecting you out there. You know, it's terrible. Welcome home, welcome home. So grateful you came back home. All these sicknesses, infirmities. Welcome home, infirmity. Welcome home. Welcome home, disease. So great to see you. Come on in there. Come on in, all of you. We're all grateful that you've returned. And then they're just all still, completely still. So the whole fear of disease, sickness, accident, all this stuff, gone. It's just this massive stillness now in peace. Allah Ramana Maharshi. He'd already, you know, had done this, and so he came in the world again, and he said, okay, time to guru up here. So he just welcomed death home, and poof, that was it. Piece of cake. Piece of cake. He had to honor time, you know, by coming here. He was honoring time, and it was compassionate outreach thing. So he had a body, you know, and the body seemed to grow up and like a normal child and everything. And he said, okay, you know, time to get down to business here. Welcome death home, no projection, and just completely took the whole world, as it were, welcomed it all home, everything, boom, finished. Okay, time to go to Arunachala and start radiating the stillness and the peace for the collective benefit of the world, all of us, for all our, help us out with our projections. That's it, he just got down to business. But this is, of course, someone who's already enlightened previously. And you know, it's not that easy for us. You know, we struggle with it a bit, but we're getting it. Watching Ramana Maharshi, you know, videos, I make some, made another one. The benefit is more than we realize. It's way more than we realize. This is a very, very potently helpful teacher, Ramana Maharshi. Okay, we have pictures of him. So you may think, oh, I'm not getting any help. Say, oh no. No, because this whole stillness thing, this whole thing of projections and stillness, it's all clarifying. This is part of his work. This is what he wants. This is what Jesus wants. This is what all the non-dual teachers want. They've all helped us. They've all lightened the load for us a great deal, actually. So it's very helpful. I may go in and do some more Rama Maharshi videos. It's not easy, believe me, doing these videos. It takes a real commitment because I don't want to spend too much time on them. So I have to get it done fast. And so, you know, boy, I have to, you know, do one slide at a time, add everything. I wish they just let me add it, but it's a lot of meticulousness and then double checking, make sure there's no mistakes. And it took me like about, I don't know, maybe 5 hours of intense focus. And I get kind of nervous and jumpy because this is really, I wish I could do it quicker, you know, but no. So I'm a little bit like, oh boy, I don't know if I really want to dive into another project because it is a lot of work. As far as the nerves go and intensity and all this stuff, and you're always afraid the computer's going to screw up. You have to be very, very meticulous and careful and to do it in the right way. And click, 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 change the font. Every, you know, freaking slide I have to change the font. Go through the settings, adjust where the font is on the page, and it's very tricky to adjust that. You got to get exactly right place on the page. It's trying to make it the same every one. You're doing the slider; it doesn't get on the right percentage you want. Yeah, sometimes it takes a long time to adjust this little slider. Ah, you're going crazy because it does. Why can't I just type in 15%? Boom! No, you got to move the slider and with your mouse, and it keeps sliding past what you want. Keeps sliding. It's exhausting, very exhausting and frustrating. So it's like, oh gosh, is there some better way? I don't know. I don't know if I want to jump into in that again, but we'll see. Too boxed in, you know, it's not creative enough, it's too boxed in, but it is helpful. It is helpful if we keep putting our focus on these great teachers. Very helpful. We don't realize how helpful it is because we don't understand how they're helping us. So there's no way to measure it, but I'm saying now, I'm seeing it. Maybe Anandamayi at some point, you know, I'm still seeing through her, you know, seeing what she's about, and it's so intense and profound, because she dealt with even with all the sicknesses and infirmities and everything, the whole schmear, you know. So we'll see. I don't know. It's easy for people to not understand that, to get that. Every time I try to include her, the program gets messed up, and I can't do it. It's blocked. Too intense, you know. It's too intense. So first, Ramana. Ramana is also super intense, but he just sat there quietly, and you know we can relate to this a little better than the idea of a teacher getting severe cancer. You know, he like freaks us out, like, oh wow, that's a separate will, personality. Maybe she was just some sort of, you know, goddess figure who was, you know, here to get us to worship her, blah, blah. No. So, you know, they misinterpret what's happening. They misinterpret it. Easily misinterpret it. So just say, no, the cancer came to see me. It's just all diseases have forms. They're all projections. They all have forms, actually. She said, this, I can see the subtle form of cancer. And she said, it came in and requested darshan of me, just like all you want satsang darshan of me. So I don't turn any of you away. Why should I turn the cancer away? People say, what are you talking about? But she said, no, I'm telling you the truth. I can see the subtle form is just sitting here with me, just like you are, just enjoying. She says, it wants to enjoy my... She says, I don't turn anyone away. I don't turn any projection away. And this, you know, caused consternation with the people. She says, oh my gosh, you're dying. You know, this is terrible. And she says, no. I won't leave you. Don't worry. When it goes and it wants to go, it can go. Just like you. Same thing. You'll have enough and then you'll go. So. So that's pretty heavy stuff, but we're at that spot right now. I'm at that spot, at least. I'm seeing it now. Not that I'm going to give darshan to cancer, you know, but I understand calling it in, the projections, we can call all projections in. So for us, the whole realm of suffering is gone. Gone. Death, gone. Suffering, gone. Misery, gone. Sickness, gone. Every whole realm of suffering, flattened out, totally at peace, still peace. Totally within our reach right now. Thanks to these great teachers, you know. Absolutely thanks to these great teachers. The idea that somebody could have got this on my own, no way. No way. So, I want to bring these great teachers into this, because the success is because of them, you know, and partially because of me, but you know, mostly because of them. Couldn't have done it otherwise. So I'm not going to say, oh yeah, I just, you know, did this on my own and I was enlightened. And no way, it didn't happen like that. That's a personality dream of doing it that way. You get a personality teacher, they say, well, I'll help you out, and they'll get two personalities, and they say, well, we'll share the credit and leave it at that. And no, I'm sharing credit with at least, you know, seven heavyweights. Buddha, Jesus, Shankara, Longchenpa, Ramana Maharshi, and Anandamaya Ma, and Jesus, of course, in miracles. You know, Jesus the first, you know, first time he came, and then second time. So I'm sharing credit with seven great non-dual teachers, absolutely. Because they're not in a vacuum either. I mean, Anandamaya Ma, what she did, I mean, that came on the shoulders of these teachers too, right? I mean, as far as helping out, people being able to welcome her here, they couldn't have welcomed her here unless it had to do with all these other teachers helping out too. So it's a collective effort here. Same with Ramana Maharshi. There was a culture there that allowed him to be there. The great sages of southern India. A lot of great non-dual sages that we don't know so well, southern India, actually. Lineages, you know, lots of them. Very intense. And so he was able to come there because they had helped pave the way too for the people to accept the situation. So very much a collective effort. Not that we have to be exhaustive in crediting everything, no. But certainly make it clear, you know, that the credit is shared. And at the same time, we don't have to diminish what we've done, because we put in, I mean, we have to call our own projections home, and that's very tough work. So they're not going to like hog the credit either. They're going to say, no, you did a ton of work, you know. It's not like when we give them credit, they're going to say, okay, I'm going to take it all. No. They say, hey, great job, you know, great job. Glad I could help out a little bit, you know, like that. They're very self-effacing that way. Because it seems like, certainly seems like, you know, that we're doing the lion's share of the work. But really, we couldn't be doing it at all if it weren't for them. Because we'd just be off on a personality trip. Wouldn't have seen through it. Can even see through the spiritualized personality. A lot of people in India have heard it for so long, they're able to say very wise things, but it's just the personality saying this, you know. Just ordinary people, you know, you'd be surprised. The ordinary people there, oh yeah, there's no, you know, there's no world, everything's projected. They seem like, wow, that's a very non-dual, it must be brilliant. But no, they just, it's so much part of the culture that they just know this is what they're supposed to say I'm a good personality, this is what I say. They haven't really called their projections home, you know. They're not really working to call their projections home. They just know the rhetoric of it. So that gives us sort of a false impression of advancement, really. So that can be very troublesome. The teachers run into that in India. They keep going to the teachers, say, look, teacher, I'm parroting, you know, what some teachers have said. So I got it. You know, I got it. And the teacher says, no, you don't got it at all. You're just saying that, you know, you don't really see, you're not really experiencing the context of it. But this, you know. And so it drives the teachers crazy over there, you know. This is because the Indians are taught, this is what, you know, you're supposed to say to the teacher to make the teacher happy and tell them, oh yeah, I know the non-dual. I can quote the Bhagavad Gita or something. I can quote the Upanishads, or I can tell, you know. But are they really calling their projections home? Or are they just trying to be a good personality? Say, I got a spiritual will and a personality will, and we get along. I'm trying to get along with it, you know. That can be quite maddening. Yeah. At least in the West, some people just say, I don't know. I don't really know. It's actually a bit more helpful. I'm really not sure. I don't really know. Let me just pay attention. So I was helped out by that. I just paid attention, just looked at it, and said, let me just see what's really going on. I don't know what to say here. I don't know. Instead of having kind of a rote, you know, response that I've programmed in, saying, of course I know what this is. This is the non-dual teaching. This is talking about the emptiness. This is talking about that there's only one. I said, I don't know what that, I said, but I don't know what that means. There's no context for it. I don't understand what it means at all, so why even bother talking like that? So Indians can be our great bluffers, you know, great spiritual bluffers. Again, that's why like Nisargadatta Maharaj got so irritated, it threw him out. Get out of here. You're just saying what you think I want to hear. You're not really engaging at all with the reality of the situation. Got him so, you guys, he'd get irritated, very irritated. They just wanted to take advantage of him. You know, they'd say, yeah, okay, teacher, I told you what you wanted to hear. Now, yeah, I want you to do what, you know, do for me what I want you to do. I did what you wanted me to do, which is pretend to be a good student. Now I want you to come and help out my sick wife and my job. And, you know, can you help go to the funeral of this? And can you give me a blessing with this? And blah, 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 you know, all this stuff. This is what they really want. No, that's what they want. That's what they think they really want. But it's not what they really want. They really want liberation from suffering, right? So in some ways, it's very tough to teach over in India. Very, very difficult. They got the shtick down, you know, very, very good shtick of, they think they know what to say to please the teacher. You know, so I'm not here to please the teacher. I'm here to get encouragement to, you know, how do I call my